welcome back. You know the drill. Get in the Facebook group, etc., etc. Way too much news today. I actually planned on like doing a little bit of draft stuff. Like, here's the latest with which teams are checking out which guys, but no time, man. It's too crazy out there, and I gotta try to wrap this up in about 40 minutes maximum. So that's gonna be my goal. Let's don't jump into it. 49ers with $64 million in cap signed Weston Richburg. He's listed as a center guard. I'm assuming he's going to jump in as a center because that is a need. I just like what the 49ers are doing. You know, you go through free agency and you're seeing a lot of signings, and it's like, what is the point of this? I don't even understand. Like, okay, he didn't cost anything, but he's never going to start on your team. I just don't get it. 49ers are going for quality. Jimmy Garoppolo, Richard Sherman, Weston Richburg. They're all big needs. They're all very good football players, and they're all going to go toward bringing the 49ers from a horrible football team to a Super Bowl contender. And I'm excited about that because that's now a thing in the NFL. It's not like it takes 5-6 years of building. It's just like, boom, you draft well, all of a sudden you're a great team. You make good signings, you're a good team. Not a guarantee, and it's kind of bottlenecked at the top. There's a lot of teams kind of fighting for that spot. But the 49ers are putting themselves in contention. I don't actually know. It says 5-year contract. I didn't look it up. This was an early yesterday note. So maybe the details are in. But again, $64 million in cap space. I'm not sure if that included Sherman or whatever. But either way, plenty of money. Bears are going all in trying to get their quarterback some help. So they signed Trey Burton. 4-year, $32 million. Trey Burton's a solid tight end. You know, again, you guys know I'm a Packers fan. But you know, I don't hate it. I think it's a little too much money. I mean, he's now, let's see, $8 million a year. It's a 4-year, $32 million contract. He's the fifth highest paid tight end. He's making more money than Greg Olsen and just $500K less than Zach Ertz. So, and I know when you get new contracts, that just gets bumped up and up and up. So it's not like they're saying he's better than Greg Olsen necessarily, but $22 million on a wide receiver tight end combo when you factor in Allen Robinson is a lot. And then they signed Taylor Gabriel. Now, you know, $59 million minus the $22 million, and then this is another, I actually don't even know. I don't have the details on that either. But, you know, it's a little bit of a dent, but you gotta understand or at least believe that the Bears are somewhat respectable. The Bears' defense under Vic Fangio just continues to get better. I mean, if you have Pro Football Focus, go in there, pick any player, and it's just like this, like steps. Every single year, every single player, with the exception of like two, and most of them are like 90 years old and their play is just dipping off, every single one of these guys consistently gets better. They got Vic Fangio back. They're bringing back a lot of their defenders, a lot of their quality players. So there's every reason to believe they're going to continue to be better. Their quarterback is now a second-year guy. They have extreme speed with Taylor Gabriel. They have a fairly solid tight end to Trey Burton. Whether you think it's a good value or not, they can afford him. They need him. They got him. You know, getting that relief valve for your young quarterback, I think, is extremely important. And then Allen Robinson. I don't want to get him confused because I was just looking at Allen Hurns a second ago. It is Robinson, though, that they got. I'm not as big on Robinson as a lot of people are, but I'm willing to concede that he's great because everybody's talking about how great he is. Okay, you know, he's got an injury history and he's, I don't know, we'll see what it is. But bottom line is, you know, are the Bears with the 49ers in that Super Bowl contention? I'm gonna say no, but we still have more free agency, they still have more cap, we still have a draft. You never know from year to year what's gonna happen. So if you're going into 18 still laughing at the Bears, maybe just wait a couple games and see how this thing plays out. The Bills started off the day with $39 million. They signed Star Latulale, 5 years, and again, I don't have the numbers on that. On one hand, you like it because it's a big need. They need to get better at along the defensive whatever. They were dead last in rushing touchdowns, 25th in yards per attempt. Not a good rushing defense at all. However, Starr hasn't been good in like 3 years. Like the last 3 years, he's just been kind of trash. So you know, I like the Bills. There's something about the AFC East defenses that I just respect. Maybe it's because Mike Pettine is now a Packers defensive coordinator, so I just have to assume that he's coming from a place where defense is paramount. But I like, you know, look what they did with E.J. Gaines, right? E.J. Gaines was just kind of meh. He goes over there, and he's like a top 15-ish corner. They did a real good job with him, so who knows? Maybe Starr goes over there, and he does quite a bit better than he did with the Panthers. They also signed safety Rafael Bush. I don't really get it. It's a 2-year contract worth up to 4.5, so basically they're paying him like $2 million. They already have good safeties, so I'm assuming this is just a depth thing. If you got money, okay. I guess if you want to go out and spend money on depth, that's fine. That's one of those things where it's like I just don't get it, but okay, whatever. Browns made a bunch more moves. I liked their other moves a lot better than these. They started off the day with $77.5 million. They signed defensive end Chris Smith, so edge rusher. Formerly with the Bengals, a 3-year, $14 million contract. It's not a lot of money, but he's I don't know if you want to call him depth or say he's competing, but I'm assuming he's just going to end up being depth. And for that reason, sort of a lot of money for a guy that's probably not really going to be starting. Maybe he's a rotational guy. I don't know. I mean, it's one of those things where you have a ton of cap and you have all these amazing players out there and you can make a big splash. Right, you can spend twice the amount of money you're spending on him and get a guy that's going to start and come in and make you a Super Bowl contender. Or you can spend this amount of money for a guy that's just going to sit on the bench. I don't know. I don't understand it. That's why I'm not a GM, I guess. What else did they do? Offensive tackle Donald Stevenson. This is, I think, maybe the dumbest signing I've seen of this whole group. It's only a 1-year, $2.5 million contract, but he has been legitimately the worst tackle in the NFL for 6 straight years. It's possible there's been a worse one. I don't feel like putting in the time to figure that out. I would be surprised if there has been one tackle that is worse than Donald. And again, you have money, you can spend it, but you don't have to. What is it about this guy that you want to bring him in? There's other guys, and you have a ton of money. Go get those guys. I don't know. I don't understand that at all. Then they got offensive tackle. It says offensive tackle Chris Hubbard, but I want to say he might come in as a guard. I don't know why I thought that. I don't know if it said that somewhere or what. But it's kind of just whatever, right? He's a little bit better. He might be good enough to come in and compete, but you're paying him quite a bit more money. I have at the end of this the cap being down to about $63 million, which means they're fine. It wasn't even worth me doing the calculations because they're fine. They have plenty of money to keep going out. But they got three guys that they went from, what was it, 77 to 63, and I don't think they added anybody. I don't think any of these guys are really ever going to play. So what is the point? The other interesting thing that I read was that supposedly the Browns are consulting with Bill Parcells on the quarterback type stuff, and based on people trying to derive too much information from not very much information, but it's still interesting, is that they don't think Parcells was big on Rosen. They do think he was very high on Mayfield, and they've narrowed it down. Who they are, I don't really know, but Darnold, Allen, and Mayfield are the three that the Browns supposedly probably like, with the rest being kind of just not so much. And I tend to think Allen's not going to go that early, my personal thing. Mayfield probably not, but just because they're saying that the Browns really like him and Parcells or whoever really likes him, maybe between Darnold and Mayfield. And there's still enough time that, you know, Mayfield could jump up. I don't really know. But it was just an interesting note I figured I'd throw out there. Again, a lot of this is just so that when we get back into the mock draft stuff, which if you're doing mock drafts right now, you're just lying. You're lying to yourself, okay? Don't lie to yourself. You don't even know the draft order. There's no way you know who's on what team. There's way too much information right now. So a lot of this is just trying to sort this stuff out, trying to figure out what do we still need, what is this, what is that. And then, you know, we're still trying to pick number one. Is it Saquon? Is it Mayfield? Is it Darnold? Is it Allen? Is it Rosen? Lots of stuff Arizona Cardinals signed Sam Bradford, and then they signed Mike Glennon. So, obviously, the Cardinals came into this with maybe the worst quarterback situation in the NFL after their quarterback, whose name is evading me, retired. I don't know. I mean, Sam Bradford, I think, has shown a lot of really good flashes. How's he going to do with the Cardinals? Maybe not bad, but super injury-prone. And then they went out and got Mike Glennon. On one hand, you look at it and you say, okay, the Cardinals are probably seeing the Bills push their way up, and you got the Jets, and you got the Broncos, and it's just like they're maybe just conceding. We're probably not going to get one of these top guys. So we go out and we get Sam Bradford, we get Mike Glennon, and hopefully we can get a developmental guy in the second or third or fourth round or whatever it might be, but we're kind of taking ourselves out of the race. Maybe, but it doesn't necessarily mean they have to be out of it. I mean, if a guy falls to them or if there's somebody in striking distance, maybe they trade up and get them. But this is a heck of an insurance policy for a team that really needs a quarterback. So that's just my thought, is they're looking at the layout and they're saying we're just probably not getting somebody that we want. So that's my thought on that. I didn't bother doing the contract work, but it was 1 year, $20 million for Bradford. Don't know what it is for Glennon, and I don't know what their situation was before this, but whatever, they got people that can figure that out. The Chiefs signed Sammy Watkins. This one was shocking to me, because apparently his value, according to SpotTrack, for whatever it's worth, but they had him at $6.5 million was his value, and he got signed to 3-year, $48 million, which I believe is, what, 16? So, pretty big discrepancy. Even if you say SpotTrack is stupid and they're way off, fine. But $10 million more than what they had him at is kind of crazy. So, I tend to think they overpaid. It's a big upgrade, and I don't think they're going to hate the idea. So it's a good pick in terms of need, a good signing in terms of need, but I tend to think the value is kind of garbage. They also signed Anthony Hitchens from the Cowboys. That's another $9 million a year. It depends on the structure of these contracts. You know, I'm throwing out numbers, but who knows, right? Who knows exactly how much the team has, plus restructuring and the free agents and then these contracts. It's not exactly this much per year. They can front load, back load, whatever. But just taking it at the value that it's at, this and Sammy Watkins brings the Cardinals cap down to $2 million. The Cardinals need a lot of stuff. They need offensive line. They need help on defense. They need wide receivers. They need so much stuff. They overpaid for a wide receiver. Regardless of what you think of Hitchens, you don't even have enough money to sign your draft picks now, or any free agent. So you got to start hacking away at your roster, or restructuring, or something. It's just not looking great for the Chiefs. And actually, you know what? I'm stupid, because I don't know. The Chiefs are in trouble financially. When I was thinking about all the needs they have, I had the Cardinals still in my head, so I may have gotten their needs wrong. But either way, $2 million a year is not good, and when you overpay for a wide receiver, this is the kind of stuff that's going to happen. So, regardless of their needs, they're in a little bit of trouble, and you can expect some cuts coming down the pipe. The Dolphins signed Albert Wilson and Danny Amendola, and I don't know what exactly they're doing. Between the Dolphins and the Eagles, I have no idea what's going on. I don't know if they're in some kind of weird competition, but this is just like stupid town. So the Dolphins don't have a team. They don't have anybody with any talent on the team. They cut everybody with any talent on the team. They still had negative money. They kept cutting people till they got to about like $2 million, $4 million, whatever it is. I think they got up to $2 million, and then they spend $8 million on Albert Wilson. He's a mediocre quarterback that puts them $6 million in the hole. That's just Albert Wilson. Then they signed Danny Amendola. So that's 2 years, $12 million with 8.25 in guarantees. So that's another six on top of the negative six, which puts him at negative 12. For what? What are we doing? So, I don't remember. I thought there was a third wide receiver, but you don't have a very good quarterback. You don't have an offensive line. You don't have a running back. You don't have a defense. But your plan is to spend a ton of money on mediocre to kind of good wide receivers and hope that that somehow does what? What? The core of your team is your wide receivers? Has that ever been a good strategy for anyone ever? And how do you dig your way out of this hole? What mediocre, subpar quality player do you have to cut and downgrade in order to get out of this massive hole you're in? I cannot wait to watch and see what this team is going to have to do to get out of this $12 million hole that they put themselves in. Again, numbers aren't a guarantee. I'm just doing basic math. Things can change. But this is not a good financial situation. This is a horrible situation. I said in the last episode the Dolphins are in trouble, and they just made it worse. The GM for this team is the dumbest person on the planet. I don't even know who it is. I don't care. The fact that he has a job is hilarious. If it's the same guy that signed Ndamukong Suh, which I have to assume is not the case, because how did that guy not get fired? But if it is the same guy, what are you guys doing over there? The Ndamukong Suh thing was brain damage level stupid. What are you guys paying him, like $25 million to not play for the team this year? Oh, dumbest thing. Speaking of, here we go, the Eagles. So this guy, I do know, Howie Roseman. So you won the Super Bowl, so it's so hard to make fun of you. But another team that was in the hole. So you've got four really good starting defensive linemen. Not including Barnett, who you drafted last year. So that's five. Then you go out and get Bennett. That's six. I reported on that yesterday. And now you sign Haloti Ngata. Can you see that? That's seven. The heck are you doing? Whoa, why? You don't have any money. You already paid a ton of money for a really good defense. You probably need to start cutting some of that really good defense. Maybe cut one of these defensive linemen because you have Barnett and you're kind of good now. No, we're just going to keep throwing money at stuff. You know what this reminds me of? This reminds me of The Office. Robert California. Remember that when he closes the, the Bimington branch or Birmingham? Bimington. Whatever. Whatever it is. He basically gets coked out of his mind, gets on the phone, closes a branch down, shows up the next day, and they're like, so why did you close that branch? And he's like, I closed the branch? That's exactly Howie Roseman. Dude goes out with you know what he did? He went down to Miami, where they're all getting coked out of their mind, including the GM. He goes down there to party with that guy. Those two guys are out there having a Saturday night bender, and they just start calling up people and signing everybody. This idiot signs two defensive linemen, which he doesn't need, and every time he signs somebody, the Dolphins guy picks up the phone and he signs a wide receiver. I cannot wait to see. I don't know if these guys are still partying or what, but I can't wait to see what moves they got coming down. Sheldon Richardson? Maybe he's going to the Eagles next. This is stupid. They did release Brent Celek, which gives them $5 million, which is pretty much nothing considering all these other idiotic moves. It would be a much better move had they not signed Bennett and Ngata. But either way, it does make a lot of sense. Brent Celek has not been very good in 4 years. And with Ertz there, $5 million, I think, is much more important than Brent Celek. The Giants signed Jonathan Stewart. I don't know. He's okay. He's not great. The Giants have a big pile of okay, not great running backs. But what I think it does is allows them to let Shane Vereen and Orleans Darkwa walk because they still have Gallman, Perkins, Watson, and Simmons. So basically you've got Wayne Gallman, your young guy. Perkins, you can mix in there, and now Jonathan Stewart. How that all shuffles out, I don't know, but I have to assume it's probably not just a wash, but you're saving cap to cut Vereen and Darkwa, and you might even be getting an upgrade. So, and when I first looked at it, I was like, "Yeah, this is really stupid," but it kind of makes sense. We'll see. I don't know how Jonathan Stewart's doing. He had a terrible year last year, but I think that a lot of that maybe had to do with the new running back coming in, and that the Panthers in general, just, you know, everybody that gets signed from the Panthers, you look at it and go, "Oh, this guy was trash last year." Yeah, the whole team sucked last year. So, I don't know. We'll see. I don't hate it. Jaguars signed Andrew Norwell. He was the big money, big man guard that, you know, high priority for a lot of people. But he didn't come cheap. Obviously, $13.3 million a year. It's a huge need, though. I mean, I can't even hate him for that. It brings the Jaguars down to $14 million. But, man, you know, that team needs offensive line. Not necessarily because their offensive line sucks the most in the NFL, but just because there's so much wasted potential, right? The quarterback gets helped a lot by the offensive line, and when you've got a kind of whatever kind of quarterback, plus you got all these wide receivers now, which you kind of want to be able to throw the ball to, blocking for him, but then also having a place for Fournette to run. I mean, the guy was really impressive as it is, and they didn't have an offensive line last year. So now you go out and you get one of the best guards in the NFL. Not great for your cap, but I can't hate it. The big question for me, though, is how long can you pay these guys, right? That's the big question for all this, and I got into an argument with Vikings fans yesterday because they all seem to think that cap doesn't matter, and it's basically like the United States government. We can just run up deficits and nobody cares. You run out of money, and you do have a cap, and you have to hold to that, and they basically went out and paid for this big defense, and they paid for this guard, and I just kind of wonder if this is a one final year push before next year when we just have to start gutting this defense. And we'll see. You know, I mean, the one way to subside a massive fall off a cliff is to draft well and to manage your cap, right? Slowly cut guys. Paul Posluszny did retire after 11 years. That helps a little bit, right? They drafted a guy, really, really good guy like Miles Jack. That's exactly what you need to do. You draft young, talented guys. You offload the old, expensive guys. And you can kind of keep this thing going. But they spent so much money on these guys. There's only so much money to go around, and the more success you have, the more these price tags go up. So it's going to be very hard to manage and maintain. So the Jaguars, I don't hate them for going all in because they need to win, right? The Eagles went all in, and they won a Super Bowl. Jaguars are playing a dangerous game with their cap, signing all these guys. So they definitely need to make a strong push. On that note, they also signed Dante Moncrief. So I looked up this morning the details on that. There was still nothing as far as how much he's getting paid. But from what I can tell, they're basically capped out. On top of the Shane Wynn, who they extended. Let's see. Oh, and Marquise Lee is 9.5. So like I said, they were at about 14. You subtract 9.5 million. And then you also have Shane Wynn and Dante Moncrief. They're out of money. And the other unfortunate thing about that is the Dante Moncrief thing is supposed to be, we're going to offload talent, downgrade a little bit, but save some cap. But still, at the end of this, because of Andrew Norwell and everything else, you still don't have cap. And you still probably don't have enough to sign your free agents or your draft picks, whoever free agents you have left out there that you would like to sign. So maybe the purging is about to begin sooner than next year, because again, there's no money. And I'm relatively new to really watching a lot of teams and their cap, so I don't really know how you can navigate these things, because there's a lot of teams that are just blowing it out. So it'll be interesting and a good learning experience to try to figure out how you manage this, right? Do you just go in with a hacksaw and start cutting? Do you renegotiate a bunch of contracts and to just try to see some of the creative ways teams can manage this stuff? Because as it stands right now, half the NFL can't even sign their draft picks. Jets finally went all in. They were sitting at the top, the absolute most cap space of anyone, and I like what they did. I'll start with Isaiah Crowell because that's the one I don't like. I mean, they don't have a good running back. They need a running back. They went out and got a running back, but Crowell's just not very good. maybe it's a scheme thing. You know, there's always that, and fans are always quick to say it because they just always assume this is the thing. I don't even think fans actually know. It's their favorite thing to say is that he's a good fit, right? Oh, they didn't know how to use him in Cleveland, but he fits better with our scheme. Everybody says that about everybody. I don't think you know what you're talking about. You just say that. But we'll see. I don't know. I mean, Crowell did have, like, that one good year. But I just don't see that being a real big thing. And I don't know how much they're paying for him. Considering how much money they have, I guess you can just say whatever. It's as long as he has potential, it doesn't really matter. But that's the one I didn't really care for. Teddy Bridgewater, though, they did sign. I think they said it was a one-year, $10 million thing. I just remember that. I didn't put it down, thankfully. But I kind of like that. I was listening to another podcast. I don't remember which one it was, but they were talking about how the Vikings, and like I just got done saying, is kind of a stupid thing, but these aren't just fans. These are guys who analyze the situation, and they said Bridgewater just was in a terrible situation. He was set up to fail by the Vikings. That specific system that they had, it was like 7-step drops and just 2 wide receivers running routes, which means nobody's really open, and with that terrible offensive line, he basically just had to turn around and get hit in the mouth, or turn around and real quick throw it to your check down. So to be able to be put into a different system, I don't know what the Jets run, but it's very likely that we never really got to see the ceiling of Bridgewater and how good he can be. There's a big question about his injury history, there's a big question about where he's at now with his recovery. Because you never really know how well people can recover from that kind of stuff. But I like it. I like a guy with Bridgewater's upside being signed for $10 million. Now, it's only 1 year, so the negative thing is if he does well and you want to retain him, his number shoots through the roof, right? If he's a starting quarterback, he's getting paid $25 million at least, right? So that's the one negative thing. I mean, if you really think you're getting a steal, sign him for 3-4. But, you know, it could be another thing, too, where he's betting on himself, so he wanted the one-year deal, whatever the situation may be. Tremaine Johnson, number one guy out there. You know, if you look at his Pro Football Focus grade, it's not as good as it should be. But this is a guy who shadowed the best of the best, right? Some of these guys have inflated grades, some not so much, because the PFF doesn't adjust for who you're going up against. So if you shadow Julio Jones and the guy over there shadows Taylor Gabriel and you end up with the same score, it doesn't mean that you guys played the same. It's actually like this, because you had Julio Jones. So you did as well as this guy going up against much better competition. That's Tremaine Johnson, always shadowing the top guys. And he does really well, very physical. His 40 time wasn't great, but he's always in guys' hip pockets. I was watching him because the Packers were supposedly interested in him. And, yeah, he was always in play. You know, these guys like Julio, they're always going to make their plays because they're elite guys, they're top-end guys. But they always had to fight for it because Tremaine Johnson was always there. So very, very expensive pickup. But, again, the Jets had plenty of room. I have this bringing them down to $67.6 million. That doesn't include Isaiah Crowell because I don't know exactly what he cost. But, you know, again, you got the money, and now you have a true number one corner. So, pretty solid there. Wait a minute. Oh, there it is. There's the note on Teddy Bridgewater. I just messed that up, but that's fine. The final thing they did, they agreed to terms with Avery Williamson. I don't know the price on him either, but again, it doesn't matter. They have plenty of money. But this is a guy who last year really tore it up. It's kind of one of those things that's kind of iffy because it was one good year, so you kind of always worry about that. But it's when he's young enough, as Avery Williamson is, it's like his fourth or fifth year or whatever. So he had a couple not-so-great years, and then boom, right? So what happened with that boom? Can you replicate that becomes the question. But he was ranked top 10 by Pro Football Focus, and you pair him with DeMario Davis. You know, I like it. And they still have a ton of cap room, so, you know, They have the ability to make some more moves. I don't exactly remember all their needs, but, you know, protect your cap. Don't do stupid stuff. Draft well. Maybe sign a couple more pieces in here. You know, I'm sick of the Patriots, so got to root for the Jets to kind of step. I shouldn't do that. I should be – if I can say nice things about the Bears, I should be able to be nice to the Patriots. But – It would be nice to see somebody in that division compete. Can I just say that, maybe? Can one of these guys step up and do something? Unlike the coked-out Dolphins and, I don't know, somebody please do something that's not horrible. A bunch of horrible football teams out there, except one. The Green Bay Packers. The horrible news was that they released Jordy Nelson. We were all in mourning over here. It's looking like he might go over to Oakland. We'll see. Their GM used to be with the Packers, so they're very familiar with Jordy. But they were able to save about $10 million in cap, which they absolutely needed, because then they turned around and they signed Jimmy Graham and Muhammad Wilkerson. Pretty torn on it, only because, you know, again, when you're talking with fans, they seem to think that cap is unlimited. People were throwing a fit. After Jimmy Graham and Muhammad Wilkerson, people were throwing a fit that we didn't sign Tremaine Johnson. What money are we going to sign Tremaine Johnson with? We have nothing left. I mean, we what is it? It's like 20, $26 million. We signed Jimmy Graham to $10 million. That brings us down to $16 million. Muhammad is $5 million. That brings us down to $11 million. $4 million for draft picks at least. So we're talking $6 million. And we have to pay who's the quarterback of the Packers again? What is his name? I can never remember his name. Aaron frickin' Rodgers. He's about to get a massive payday. So all this talk about we need to be signing more people, I think we might be done. I just got done doing my Packers podcast, which, by the way, if you are a Packers fan or if you're interested, I not only have the Packers podcast, which is the Packernet podcast, if you want to look it up, but I just started doing, it's basically the exact same thing that you're seeing here with the little ticker bar and all the other stuff, but it's just Packers, and it's that podcast in YouTube form. So if you search YouTube for Packernet podcast, you can see that. Just got my second one uploaded today. But anyways, what I had said in that podcast was I tend to think Clay Matthews is out the door, and it's going to be a tough move, but I think we need the money. Clay Matthews counts zero in terms of dead money, so we would get like 11 some million dollars. With that money, you could turn around and you could get, you know, maybe get another wide receiver to compensate, because we do need, there's nobody. You know, Randall Cobb is a slot guy. When Jordy went down, we put Randall outside. He's no good out there. Jimmy Graham is a receiving tight end, but you don't want him to just be an outside guy, right? He's supposed to be matching up against linebackers and stuff. So Geronimo Allison is not good enough. We're going to have to get another guy, and we need to seriously start looking at corners. So considering there's no money, I would – I'm the only one really saying it for some reason. I don't know why, but I really think Clay is on the way out. And as much as we need edge rush help, paying $11.2 or whatever it is, million dollars a year for a 33-year-old guy that gets six sacks a year, I think we'd rather have the money. So – That's just my thought on that. The Carolina Panthers signed Bashaud Breeland from the Redskins, 3 years, $24 million. Nothing special. Bashaud Breeland is a pretty average guy. But when you consider the fact that the Panthers' highest graded, if you go to Pro Football Focus, their highest graded corner was Ladarius Gunter. Ladarius Gunter, for those that probably don't know, because nobody outside of Green Bay or Carolina knows who Ladarius Gunter is, he's the guy that the Packers cut because he wasn't good enough to make the Packers' defensive back group. Packers' defensive backs, pretty much the worst in the NFL, Ladarius Gunter, everyone else on the Panthers. So, huge upgrade here. But that's a lot of money for the Panthers. I don't exactly know. Let's see. So I said that after Graham Gano, who they signed, they're sitting at about $6.5 million. So another one where, you know, it's hard to justify that for me, Bashaud Breeland. Maybe they just like him. You know, it's easy to just go on Pro Football Focus, look at a grade, and say, oh, he's this or that. It's not that easy. These guys are actually putting in work and watching film, and it's about fit and scheme and all this stuff. That's fine. But, you know, we'll see. I wouldn't be too optimistic, especially when, you know, things are that bad. How much of an upgrade is it going to be for your defensive back group? Even if Breeland is a freak, fine, I'm going to throw over there. So, I don't know. And can he really match up against the number ones? Because if this is your number one corner now, if, I don't really know, maybe there was somebody that was injured that's just escaping me. But if he's your number one, I mean, who does he match up against? I don't know. But it's, you got to do it, right? If you don't have somebody and you're the GM, your job is to fill holes. You have a massive hole here. Here's something to fill a hole with. There you go. But I think the Panthers are pretty well done. The Oakland Raiders signed tight end Derek Carrier, which I swear to you, I thought they honestly said tight end Derek Carr because it's Derek Carr plus I-E-R. Not a whole lot to talk about here. He's just kind of a meh guy. I can't imagine he's going to add that much. But again, the bigger news is probably the fact that they might be signing Jordy Nelson. I'm kind of curious what he might get signed for if he gets signed over there, only because he got cut with the Packers at about $12 million. We only saved $10 million, but his cap number was $12 million. I tend to think, you know, depending on the free agency frenzy, how big his market is, he could be getting upwards of that much or more. So he could be a pretty expensive guy. I mean, he had a bad year because Brett Hundley was throwing him the ball, but he's consistently one of the top guys, if not the top guy, in touchdown receptions every year. So, I don't know, just, I guess, for my own personal sake as a fan, I'm curious to see where he goes. As long as he doesn't go somewhere in the NFC North or to the Patriots or Cowboys or one of the other teams that I don't care for, I'm happy. Raiders would be fine. Ravens released Danny Woodhead. you know, they don't save a ton of cap, but it's just one of those things. If you don't have plans for him, you just cut him, and you get to save $1.8 million. He's 33 years old. If you're planning on moving on from him, just go ahead and do it. They're pretty strapped for cash, so it's, I don't know how much this is actually going to help, but again, if he's not in your plans, just cut him. They then, again, not very much money, but they signed John Brown from the Cardinals to a $5 million contract, which, according to the math that I did, which again is just this plus this minus this, it's not anything concrete. But just using basic raw numbers and averages, the team has about $9 million left. John Brown is kind of so-so, but he's a very fast guy. So if your contention is, and I don't know, again, I'm not a Ravens fan, I don't exactly know what the whole thing is, if it's a speed issue or what it is, but if it is a speed thing and you've been screaming for speed, you got speed. Then they went out and signed Ryan Grant, four-year, $29 million. Again, according to that same awesome math, they're now sitting at $1.75 million, which means you got to cut guys, which I don't like this. I just don't understand. You went out and signed a bunch of free agent wide receivers last year. It didn't go very well. Every single wide receiver underperformed, probably because you don't have a very good quarterback, no offense. The guy's just no good, and then, again, the Ravens are like, well, I know what we'll do. We'll just sign more wide receivers. What is it with these teams and just thinking, man, if we just had elite wide receivers, you know what we're going to do? We're going to sign mediocre wide receivers. Bring them here, they'll become elite wide receivers, and then we'll have good wide receivers and a not good quarterback and a not very good team in general. What is this? What are we doing here? We have no cap room left because we want to sign these just kind of wide receivers. What are you going to do? What is the best case scenario here? Are you going to the playoffs with this team? Is John Brown and Ryan Grant going to bring you to the playoffs? No? Then just stop. Stop. Please stop. I don't know. Maybe you're going to be cutting some of these other guys that you signed last. I would hope so. You know, Jeremy Maclin, I don't know the situation there. Maybe it was a one-year deal and they're going to let him go and that'll save money. I don't really know. I'm not sure. Again, you let me know. But I look at that and I just shake my head and go, why am I not a GM? Because I swear I could do better than half these teams because this is ridiculous. Send me to Miami. I promise you I will not do coke. Not interested in that. You can pay me, just give me like $250,000. Be comfortable with that. And although I don't know if I can afford anything in Miami for $250,000. Pretty expensive out there, I would assume. Just a $500,000. $500,000, I'll be good to go. I will clean up that team. Anyways, enough picking on the Dolphins. So easy, though. It's like kicking a puppy, man. It's just too easy. Redskins agreed to terms with wide receiver Paul Richardson, five-year, $40 million contract. Once again, we've added another average wide receiver to a pile of average wide receivers. This is what we love to do in the NFL these days. We have average wide receivers. We only have 6, and I really wish we had 7. Let's add another one. I don't know how you justify paying $8 million to go from average to average, but I guess Richardson has to go somewhere. Redskins seem to like him. I don't know their cap situation. I didn't look it up. I'm not going to look it up now. I'm just bored with this wide receiver stuff. It's so boring. Who's going to throw him the ball? If the problem with your wide receivers is your quarterback, and you bring in a wide receiver that's just as good as your other average wide receivers, what exactly is our goal here? Can we fix the offensive line? Can we upgrade our defense? Can we upgrade the quarterback? I mean, there's core foundational things. A pass rusher, an offensive line, a left tackle, a quarterback. Wide receiver is just, blech. Whatever. I mean, unless you're going to go out and get, you know, a top-tier guy. You know, if you signed Allen Robinson, you look at it and go, okay, fine. He's one of the top guys on the market. Sure, go for it. Hey, go get Jordy Nelson. I'm not just being biased. The dude is still pretty good, right? He's despite being called injury prone, he's not. But Paul Richardson, why? What are we? Whatever. Saints re-signed Drew Brees, 2 years, $50 million. The guy clearly had no intention of leaving New Orleans. I'm thinking he was talking to other teams because he wanted the Saints to offer him more money. You know, just threatening, I'll leave. But he wasn't going anywhere. I forget exactly what it was because I didn't put it down in the notes, but I saw yesterday he was offered, I think, 50 million, or six, two teams offered him 60 million just in guarantees. So I don't know if it was 60 million fully guaranteed or 100 million was 60 million guaranteed, but he ended up taking $25 million a year, 27 million guaranteed. So yeah, he was never planning on going anywhere. So, but, you know, I kind of like it because the Saints finally, you know, he's been handicapping this team for a while. I don't mean to be rough on Drew, but, I mean, he's been getting paid a lot of money. And when you have a quarterback that gets paid a lot of money, it hurts in other areas. And when you have that, you need a team that can draft well, and the Saints haven't been drafting well, and they haven't had a defense, and it's just, you're never going anywhere. But finally, they've got a good defense, right? They have these corners, these young corners, and they got this young running back in Alvin Kamara, and they just have this potential. Now is the one time when you can't lose Brees. We finally have a shot at going somewhere. So yeah, let's lock them up for 2 years. We got 2 years. We're gonna make a run at this thing, and hopefully we can get a Super Bowl out of one of these 2 years. After that, we'll see. I mean, we still have all this other talent. We got to find a quarterback at some point, but. You know, we got 2 years to make this thing work. Texans signed Aaron Colvin, cornerback, to 4 years. I don't know how much they're paying him, but the Texans have a ton of money. So Colvin is one of the top cornerbacks in the class. It's a need. So nothing to really dislike about it. You need a cornerback. You get one of the best ones, and you have more than enough money to make it work. I don't know how much money he costs, but it's going to be hard to be upset either way. Titans are another team. Tons of money. They went out and got Malcolm Butler and Deion Lewis, and I'll be completely honest, I don't understand the Malcolm Butler thing. Packers fans wanted Malcolm Butler, and I just kept saying, why? Why do we want Malcolm Butler? I don't understand why he's considered the top guy. It's almost as though we forget that the guy was benched in the Super Bowl. He wasn't even the top guy in New England. Who was it? It was Gilmore. Crockett Gilmore was the number one guy in New England. Crockett Gilmore was shadowing the number one guys, and they put Malcolm Butler shadowing the number two guys. And even as the number two guy, he was graded as average. So he's going up against lesser competition, and he can't even get a good grade. And then by the end of the year, the Patriots looked at it, and they're like, you know what? I don't even want you on the field during the Super Bowl. And somehow, this guy, who made one good play in the Super Bowl and had like one good year at corner, who's playing against the number twos and number threes on other teams in a garbage division, is somehow some elite cornerback prospect that we have to pay over $10 million a year to. 5 years, $61 million contract. I would be shocked if he does well. Let's put it that way. And they don't really, I mean, they don't have a huge need at corner. They have some decent corners. Now everyone's saying, oh, now they got a true number one, plus all these young guys. Man, they got a legit cornerback group. He's not a true number one corner. in my opinion. He never was in New England. Why do you think he's going to be here? I don't know. I don't get the hype at all. I don't understand it. You know, you watch Trumaine Johnson, and then you watch Malcolm Butler, and it's not even comparable. Again, Malcolm Butler is playing against the number twos. He's playing a lot of zone. He's just kind of lingering in areas. Trumaine Johnson is just locking down number ones. That's all he does. Not even close. Not even comparable. Now, Trumaine made more money, but I don't get the Malcolm Butler thing. Deion Lewis, though, no problem with that. Again, they have plenty of money, so I don't know exactly how much they're paying him, but it doesn't really matter. They got rid of DeMarco Murray. So, if it's anything even close to a one-for-one, paying him as much as DeMarco Murray, it's an awesome, awesome upgrade. Deion Lewis was a top-five guy, according to Pro Football Focus. I don't know how much of that has to do with New England, but regardless, the pairing of Derrick Henry and Deion Lewis and offloading DeMarco Murray, I think that's a great move. Skeptical of Malcolm Butler, but either way, lots of money, and you spent it on guys that can actually help you. Compared to some of these other nonsense pickups of guys that are just never going to play, you're spending $2 million on a guy that's going to sit on your bench and get cut next year. Okay. Anyways, the last one now is the Vikings. I already kind of alluded to this, the Kirk Cousins thing. I got into an argument on Twitter because my entire contention, and of course, this probably happens with every fan base, if you say anything bad or logical but against their wishes, they're going to flip out. But all I really said was, you can't pay top money to a quarterback and top money to a defense. And you're paying top quarterback to a guy that's not even a top quarterback. I mean, in terms of his, you know, what is it, DVOA and Pro Football Focus or whatever kind of metrics you want to use, you know, raw statistics, fine, he was fine. But Pro Football Focus and the defensive value adjusted over or whatever it is, he's been average. He's been just kind of okay. And you're paying top-tier money for him, and that's going to hurt your defense. Well, you got to figure that the cap is going to increase every year. So what? So is everybody's price tag. You've got like five guys that are up for a contract on your defense next year. You just can't keep them. And this ensures that you're not going to be able to keep them. So 2018, absolutely watch out for the Vikings. I think this is an upgrade at quarterback. They have really good wide receivers. They have maybe the best defense in the NFL. And they've got their rookie running back from last year who's returning. I mean, there's no reason to believe the Vikings aren't one of the front runners for the Super Bowl. So I'm not trying to just trash the Vikings. They're an extremely good football team. I was just rubbing it in a little bit on something that I thought was self-evident, that you can't pay for Kirk Cousins and pay all these guys on your defense. That should be self-evident. But apparently in Minnesota, salary caps don't exist, and they're the only team. 31 other teams have to abide by a cap, but the Vikings don't. I don't know. But that's it. And it's exactly 6:30 now, so that's kind of awesome. You folks have yourselves a fantastic day. I'm really hoping there's not so much news tomorrow, because this is a lot of work and a lot of struggle and a lot of rushing. So be back tomorrow, because this is what I do now. This is my life. Thanks again for tuning in. And I'm really going to try this weekend to do a live mock draft, but I just don't have time to learn how to do it. But let me know in the comments. Get in the Facebook group. Let me know in there if you're watching, if you want to partake, because I don't want to learn all this stuff and set it up. And then on Saturday, doing a live streaming thing on YouTube, and five people show up, and it's like, well, this was a stupid waste of my time. So if you're interested, I kind of like to get a head count. If you're in the Facebook group or whatever, just throw it in the comment section. Yeah, I'm down. Let's do a live mock draft. Again, the plan would be to kind of get the chat. I got to make sure my hands are in this box, like a chat up here. Get kind of a big board, although I'm not going to be able to like cross off names, so it is what it is. And then maybe do like a poll from the Facebook group, just to kind of say, once we have the discussion, once we get all the things out there, like, okay, we're all set, Browns first overall, who are we picking? And we'll just kind of go down the list and we'll do it that way. It'd probably take forever, but I think it'd be a lot of fun. So again, if you're interested, let me know in the comment section, because I'd really like to do it. I think it would be a ton of fun. But again, I don't want to do it if nobody else is doing it, so be sure to get at me and let me know. Otherwise, you folks have yourselves a wonderful Wednesday. Free agency officially starts today. There's no free agents left, but it starts today at like 4, so enjoy that. Should be another fun day of signings, and hopefully you're having as much much fun as I am. Have yourselves a fantastic day.